Let us pray. O Lord God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, grateful that your Spirit indwells us, grateful that your Spirit helps to guide us into all truth so that we may be protected from error and from wrong teaching. Guide us as we study your prophet Daniel, his writings of old that are still important today. Although they might be somewhat mysterious and confusing, help us to glean what we need to from this passage to make us know you better. Be with us now in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Amen. I forgot one thing. Well, I can change it down here. We're on Daniel chapter 9. A little bit of review, just a little bit as we begin. Daniel chapter 9. We said that Daniel chapter 9, to begin with, it records two different time periods. It breaks into two sections. Both time periods involve the number 70. That's what we said. The first one, verses 1 through 19, are what we call the historical 70. The historical 70, when Jeremiah told the people, you're going to be here for 70 years, get used to it, in their Babylonian captivity. They didn't want it. The false prophets were saying, oh, we'll be home in a year. You know, we'll be home shortly. Don't get comfortable. Right. And Jeremiah is saying,
70.
Buy houses, settle down. You're going to be there 70 years. 70 years. Okay, that's the historical 70. The prophetic 70 in verses 20 through 27. Really, that's what we're going to be up to today. No, we're still on the historical 70. We're still on the historical verses. I take that back. We've got through verses 1 through 11, so we're coming up on verse 12, verses 12 through 14. And this is part of the historical verses, and we said in these historical verses that Daniel is reflecting on the nation and on their sinfulness, their disobedience to God, and he's looking at the suffering of the nation. Verse 12, thus, he has confirmed his word, which he had spoken against us, the nation Israel, and against our rulers who ruled us, to bring on us great calamity from under the whole heaven. There has not been done anything like what was done to Jerusalem. And that's the destruction of Jerusalem by the Babylonians. They came in, they destroyed Jerusalem. And what Daniel's simply affirming here is that God's word of warning have come to pass. God kept on telling them it's going to happen. And this is one of the things where they wanted their ears tickled. I like that phrase. They wanted to hear, oh, it's going to be okay, no problem. You know. When you go to your doctors, what do you want to hear? It's going to be okay, you're going to be fine. You don't want him to come in with that sad face going, oh, not going to be so good. You know, we better do some more tests.
What's that shadow on your lung?
Yeah, what's that shadow on your lung? You know, that's especially that. You know, so, I probably don't need to really interject here. Come on, work. Why are you cutting out? I taped some shows, and one show happened to be from last year, the Disney special when Disney was 100 years old. And I thought, you know, Walt Disney died at 65. And why did he die at 65? Smoked. Cancer. You know, 65 years old, what he would have been like if he lived for another 10 or 15 years. Smoking has caused more problems.
Oh, it's really, the commercials are really bearing down on it.
Well, and I love the old Perry Masons, maybe. You know, I love the old Perry Masons. But look how many people smoke. Everybody does.
I discovered Justice Channel. You get Ben Matlock, Perry Mason, and In the Heat of the Night. And on Perry Mason, everybody's got a cigarette stuck in their mouth.
I turned to Ellen the other day and said, you know, the tobacco companies knew what they were doing.
Sure.
Get the cigarettes there. They influenced a few generations, and now we're trying to break the
and
curse.
And now the big thing is about letting teenagers learn to vape to break the smoking habit. That's a lot of discussion about that.
Vaping's as bad as smoking, if not worse. Popcorn lungs. So, to dip, to chew, to smoke, cigarettes, pipes, cigars, none of it's any good.
Don't do that.
None of it's any good. There's no such thing as a safe cigarette, in my opinion. Although some people like us think there are safe. But what I'm saying, God's words come to, we warn people about the dangers of something, but they don't pay attention. And God was warning his nation for years upon years upon years. And Jerusalem, Judea, and Benjamin, the two southern tribes that stayed faithful, in quotes, to God, they observed what happened in the northern ten. The Assyrians came through and wiped the northern ten tribes out. And you thought, does that not tell you something about, but they said, we got the temple, so that'll never happen. No, it will happen. It will happen. So Daniel's looking around and he's seeing God's words of warning have come to pass. Verse 13. As it is written in the law of Moses, all this calamity has come on us. Yet we have not sought the favor of the Lord our God by turning from our iniquity and giving attention to your truth. There's a Christian singer from years ago named John Francisco. Anybody know John Francisco? You probably, Michelle May. He wrote some wonderful songs. But he talks about sinning. And even though he knows God's forgiveness, he goes, I wasted a whole day moping in my sin, in one song, basically, is what he says. And this is it. The people didn't respond. They sat in their sins, they moped, they whined, but they didn't respond. And what? All the suffering did not result in the nation turning back to God. All that they suffered, all that they saw happen to their brothers and sisters in the nation. Tom?
This is after the flood, wasn't it, during this period?
Well after the flood.
Well, that's also a big calamity.
You've got the flood, then you've got Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. You've got 40 years in captivity. You've got the period of the judges. Then you got the period of the kings, and this is way down. I think Daniel was dated around 608 BC, I think. But I mean the floods was about 1400 BC, something like that. So this is way after. But I mean, all those lessons of history, all the times you see God act, all the calamity that God brings, we're not listening. We're not paying attention. Wake up, folks. Wake up. God is not a God to be mocked. He gives you a lot. I mean, God, the writer said God is patient, wanting all to come to the knowledge of salvation, but so few turn to God. And that's, he sent the prophets, one after another, to prophesy. Turn to me. Come to me, I will bless you. But if you don't, I'm going to punish you. They got punished. All the suffering they saw, all the suffering they endured, never brought them back to God in a consistent, continual manner. Verse 14. Therefore, the Lord has kept the calamity in store and brought it on us, the nation. For the Lord God is righteous with respect to all his deeds which he has done, but we have not obeyed his voice. How loudly can we say that in our nation right now? That we have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God.
I have said, not stepping aside the acceptance of Christ, the presence of Christ, nothing else has changed. But if you go back and read it in the way back to the Old Testament, it's just war, 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 this country's fighting this country, and nothing's changed. Except the appearance of Christ was it's a whole other plateau over here. But down here, nothing's changed.
not to get particularly political, but the upcoming elections have definite concern.
Yes.
And I mean, I don't care who wins. I don't care who wins. To be honest, if you want to be, I'll be completely honest with you. I would love to see a strong third party candidate. I would really love to see. And
let's hear for Kennedy.
I'm giving serious consideration to voting for Kennedy.
Yeah.
Just because I don't really want the other two options.
He's turned a little bit liberal, but. I know what you're saying. I understand.
I mean, is he one that I would, if he were one of the two main candidates, would I vote for him? Yeah, but I mean, looking at the two main candidates, I wish there were a third strong candidate that might make a difference. I mean, the only prediction I've heard is that Kennedy will draw enough votes away from Biden that Trump will win. And I don't know if that's good. Pardon me?
One thing that this government has done that I think we should be terrified, when it first got in, it sold barrels and millions of barrels of our reserve, oil reserve. Mm-hmm. To God knows who. Billions of barrels. Then stopped all the pipeline stuff in this country. So now we're buying from you know who. Well, now gas got so high, so what do? They bring out some more of our reserves. If it dries up and there's a war, we are not a third world country, we're probably a 10th world country. I don't know why everybody's not terrified at that thought.
But that's what happened in Germany. They ran out of fuel.
And we could, the way we'll have no reserve, and we have to, they can charge us whatever they want to, if they even want to sell it to us.
And how many remember the gas shortages of the late 70s?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, sitting out there in the bays and ships. And another devil in the mix is the traders, stock market, the oil bids. They're the ones that decides on the prices that reflects to the ships out there in the bay. Mm-hmm. But they're coming in and what they're going to do. That's the main one is the trade, is the traders.
Yeah, everything that comes to happens. I mean,
the oil situation is.
But back to what you're saying, but the choice of the two. What's scary about Biden is not that. If he can't make it, like who is next in line? That's the worst part. It's not if, it's when.
I know.
She'll take her. That's the scariest part.
I know. I'm like I say, a lot of this whole thing scares me. So we'll see what happens.
But
I don't want to get too, I said, this is not, I'm just saying, I think we're seeing God's judgment upon our nation as God was judging the nation of Israel. And it's time for a lot of repentance.
Okay, I know they heard, I hope God, listen to me, God, all these nations just went to rack and ruin and God's fixed to wipe them out and then he relents. And feels better toward them and saves them. And I think that ought to be our prayer for the United States.
Yeah, God is a God of patience, waiting, wishing, hoping, desiring all to come to the knowledge of salvation.
That's right. We better hope that that's
so,
in his
that's
plan.
What it is.
What scares me is what happened in Germany. We all had them up here, back in the 40s.
Yeah.
30s.
It could. Hate is definitely growing. So anyways, God, what verse 14 is saying is that God is righteous in punishing the nation. When God punished the nation of Israel, he was righteous in what he did. Okay? Now, verses 15 through 19, as we move on, Daniel asks for forgiveness and restoration. This is what he's starting to pray. And now, O Lord, our God, who have brought your people out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand and have made a name for yourself, as it is this day, we have sinned, we have been wicked. So what is Daniel doing? Daniel's, first of all, as he starts to pray, is he reminding God of his past kindness toward his people. You know, Lord, you blessed this nation when you created this nation. But we have been a wicked people. We have gone astray.
Nothing else to do.
But God has been kind, and we want God's kindness again, but we want God's revival. O Lord, verse 16, in accordance with all your righteous acts, let now your anger and your wrath turn away from your city Jerusalem, your holy mountain, for because of our sins and the iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and your people have become a reproach to all those around us. To sum it up, Daniel is seeking God's mercy. Daniel is seeking the mercy of God on behalf of the people. This is probably a little, for us to pray for the nation in terms of, Lord, send mercy, send restoration. I mean, those are things we pray, but Daniel felt even more as far as he felt concerned beyond just what we might consider prayer. It was a sovereign move of the Spirit to see. Okay? Everything arranged?
Things great.
Did they give you a key?
They did.
Okay.
I'll see you soon.
Okay. Well, you may not see me, but you got the building.
That'll work.
Thank you, Katie.
You want some donuts to go?
Oh.
Take some donuts to go. Don't just take.
Jesus, you need donuts.
Take some donuts to go.
I love donuts. And I love donuts.
Oh, take some donuts to go, please.
Do you have the women's thing tomorrow?
Take a lot of donuts to go.
No.
Thank you.
Well, just give her all of them.
You need some weight on those bones.
Just dump the little box.
I don't have one. Anybody want one left? You can just dump them in here.
You can.
We're good.
May as well.
We're always fighting to get rid of them every Sunday.
Well, some of us have things on Monday, but I don't have anything.
I was going to say, and look, that's okay. Tomorrow's my off day. I have time to eat donuts.
I thank you very much. I will. And I will see
you. Look forward to having you.
Thank you very much.
I love you back.
She's in the car. Go, we'll talk later. Okay, if we can pause the interruption.
Sorry.
No, it's okay.
It served us well. The donuts got a home.
Donuts got a home. You know, we really do need somehow to pray in a manner that's more than just us praying, but to say, Lord, make the corporate nation again have mercy upon us, is what I'm saying. That's what Daniel's doing. He's seeking God on behalf of the nation, not just on behalf of himself. So we need to be intercessors, those who pray on behalf of the nation. Verse 17. Come on, there you go. So now, our God, listen. So now, our God, listen to the prayer of your servant and to his supplication. And for your sake, O Lord, let your face shine on your desolate sanctuary. So God, Daniel asked God to hear his prayer. We have that promise that God hears, but it's always nice to remind ourselves that God is hearing us as we pray. And to ask God, God, hear me. Hear me as I pray. Verse 18. O my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolations and the city which is called by your name. For we are not presenting our supplications before you on account of any merits of our own, but on account of your great compassion. Prayer is never based on who we are, but always based on who God is. Got me? Daniel acknowledges the unworthiness of the nation. We are not a worthy people. And I'm speaking in terms of the corporate nation. See, we are not a worthy people. God's children are worthy children. God has blessed us with life, forgiveness, shown us His mercy and His grace through the cross of His Son, by the waters of baptism, etc., etc. We've been blessed. But, see, let us not only look for our sakes, but for the sake of the nation in which God has placed us. That's unique, in my opinion, unto us. Verse 19. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, listen and take action. For your own sake, O my God, do not delay, because your city and your people are called by your name. You get the implication here. Daniel is praying that God remember, see, his people carry his name. We carry God's name. And when we dishonor, or when we do something that's inappropriate, illegal, immoral, however you want to say it, we bring shame to God's name. Our activities, our behavior, our daily living is a reflection of God's name. See, what do we pray? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Keep thy name holy in me, holy through me, holy. This day, through all things, keep thy name holy. This signal keeps dropping in here for some reason. It's crazy. That's what Daniel's doing. God, it was your city. People knew Jerusalem as the city where you reigned because your temple was there. Your people are your people. They carry your name. Don't let them be disgraced. That's what God's doing. Daniel is asking for forgiveness on behalf of the nation. Okay, so in these final verses of the historical section, you know, we got the historical section where Daniel reaffirms the writings of the prophet Jeremiah, that the people have sinned, that they're going to be in captivity for 70 years, and Daniel then, in prayer, comes to repent on behalf of the nation and to seek God's mercy on behalf of the nation. Okay? And I think we'll leave it. The next section starts the prophetic 70, and I'd rather try to do that in one session. So, yes, Tom, please.
I've got a question about the salvation part. When we die, going to heaven, the book of life is opened up, and you're judged by your actions of your life.
Correct.
Does that include, or is it a separate book of the words that you have used in your life?
I would say no. I'd say the words go along with how, what you're going to be judged on, your actions and everything. I need to show you a video by a gentleman named Carmen. Let's take a minute. We're early anyway. Let me show you this. Let me show you this.
It concerns me, because being German-Irish, I'm doomed.
this is a good video. This is about 5 minutes long.
I can wait 5 minutes before I go to the grocery. That's about it.
My library. Playlists. You gotta go down here. Where are my playlists? That's not what I want.
Is this YouTube?
Yeah, this is YouTube. I said watch later. Playlists is what I wanted. Playlists.
I love it.
Devotional songs. That's the one I want.
I've worked on it.
I hope this is still here. Some of them have gone and disappeared again. This one here.
there are many who don't quite know for sure what that verdict would be, ever. So let's imagine for a moment you're standing dead center in the courtroom of forever.
Maybe it's this other book down here. The devil cries, no, no! not that one. Gossip, then why are you so uptight? God sets the book down, the dust flies, and on the cover it says, the Lamb's Book of Life!
Videos out there, but I mean, that's an earthly picture, but you see what I'm saying?
Yes.
The devil's going to accuse you, and that's what the devil does.
Right, that's what he does.
But with Christ, everything's washed away, and your name's in the book. So, I mean, when it comes to say we're going to be judged on what we did, God wants to know, are we the obedient children he wanted us to be? And then this, you know, what is the reward that God's going to give us? It's hard. It's really up there. You know, it's never about our works. It's always about what God does. But once God has saved us, he wants us as obedient children to share his word. Is there some kind of reward attached to that? I like, you know, some people point out God's economic system is so much different than ours because he paves his streets with gold. You know, and this kind of stuff. So to be in God's presence is eternal joy forevermore. Should we be obedient children of God? Undoubtedly. Are all our sins forgiven? And the mystery of God, past, present, and future? The pages are blank. They're empty because the blood of Christ has washed us clean. And so, you know, yeah, it's a little bit Hollywood. Pardon me? Yeah, oh yeah, it gets across. I mean, Carmen unfortunately died about a year ago. Cancer struck him down. He was in remission for a while. I did meet him one time. Yeah, in Tulsa. He was in Tulsa long ago. He was a really nice gentleman. But he does a number of these videos if you want to see him. He's very good on those. So that's just some idea of, you know, yes, there's this kind of judgment waiting. But that judgment is that we've been forgiven in Christ and we have eternal life with God forevermore. So, it's not about worrying what I've done or worrying about what I'm going to do. It's Charles Spurgeon who had the saying, I think it is, it's not my hold on Christ, but it's Christ's hold on me.
That's right.
And that's what we've got to, you know, every day remember that you are Christ. He has a hold on you, and give him praise and glory and honor for all that. Okay, that help, Tom?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
Thank you.
Oh, you're very welcome, Tom. Any other questions before we dismiss? Even though Betty's not here, she can be here in spirit. Let us bow in prayer. We thank you, O God, for people like Carmen who can illustrate some truth that helps us to know it maybe a little bit better. We thank you for your word. You have warned us many times about turning away from you. Help us to heed those warnings. Help us to pray. To pray for your mercy upon our country, to pray for your grace in our lives, and to pray that you'll guide and keep us as your servants, honoring your kingdom and your name in all we do each and every day. Now remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray once again. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.